Good morning. We welcome everyone to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have one item in public today. We will hear from the Scottish Commission on Social Security on uprating regulations. All members have already indicated questions so far and themes that you wish to cover. So I'll just move to agenda item one. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item three in private. Are we all agreed? Fabulous, thank you. Our next item is an evidence session on the uprating regulations with the Scottish Commission on Social Security. And I welcome to the meeting Marilyn Howard, member of the Scottish Commission on Social Security. Hi there, good morning. And thank you for accepting the committee's invitation. I've just got a few points, the usual rules about the hybrid meetings. For Marilyn, I would just ask, please wait until I or the member asking you a question addresses you before speaking, and please allow broadcasting colleagues just a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you begin to speak. Colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerks if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question. Members online should please use the chat box or the WhatsApp. So I will move straight to questions, and to kick us off for theme one, I have questions from Paul McLennan.
Good morning, Marilyn. The first question is really just talking about adequacy of social security payments, and we all know already about the impact of the cost of living crisis at the moment. Is that affecting the realisation of social security principles?
Okay, I'm a new member of the Scottish Commission on Social Security, so I'm really pleased to be here to talk about the uprating report. Perhaps in answer to your question, I could start with outlining some of the social security principles that the Commission think is particularly important in relation to uprating, and then say a little bit about the cost of living. So the key principles that we think are important, particularly with uprating, is that Social Security is an investment in the people of Scotland. Social Security is itself a human right and essential to the realisation of other human rights. And that the Social Security system is there to contribute to reducing poverty, and that opportunities should be sought to continuously improve the system. So in terms of the cost of living, clearly increases in inflation can affect the ability of Social Security to contribute to reducing poverty and to realising various human rights, such as the right to an adequate standard of living. And it's difficult with a mechanism such as annual upratings to, on its own, to tackle the issues around the cost of living. And in particular, the turbulence that we've seen and the high rates of inflation over the past year or so means that annual uprating mechanisms are certainly relevant, but on their own can't really address some of those issues. So both the UK government and the Scottish government have introduced various cost of living measures, and also the Scottish government doubling the Scottish Child Payment bridging payments. So they are obviously important additions to uprating. Although obviously claimants had been experiencing those high rates of inflation before some of those measures could take effect, important though they are.
Marilyn, thanks for that. And can you touch on my next question, because you talked obviously about the impact of inflation. And when we looked back at a year and we looked at inflation forecasts, they were nowhere near where they actually ended up. So I suppose there's two parts to the next question. One is around about, does the underlying adequacy of benefit payments need to be reviewed? And does obviously Scots have a role in that review? And colleagues will know this is one of my favourite questions as well in terms of this. In terms of how having to deal with that, Social Security is a demand-led service. If the Scottish Government needs to find more money in terms of uprating, which it has had to this year, where does it find the money? It has to take it from elsewhere. In your opinion, should the Scottish Government and UK Government be looking to have discussions around about additional borrowing powers to deal with issues such as that? As I said, coming back to the point around about we didn't forecast inflation anywhere near where it would be this year.
Certainly the adequacy of social security benefits is really important, although in relation to the uprating report, we haven't really looked into that. But I would think the Commission would be well placed to participate in any review that the government might undertake. I'm afraid I'm not really in a position to comment on borrowing. That is that's beyond the SCoS remit.
Okay. Marilyn, thank you for that. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you very much, Paul. I'll now move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for joining us. My question relates to the points that you yourself have raised there around the covering of the cost of living. And I wonder, are you aware of any plans to assess the real cost of living and additional costs faced by disabled people in Scotland?
I'm not aware of work of that nature, no.
Are you aware of when that was last done?
I'm not, no. I don't know if any of my colleagues are. We could certainly maybe take that away and send the committee a note if we can find further information.
That would be really helpful. And also, in terms of the review of adult disability payment and child disability payment, it was really just to get an understanding of whether you thought the payments as they stand are adequate to cover those costs?
Right. That wasn't something that we considered in this particular report, because we were looking at the uprating regulations for this particular year. But it is obviously the disability payments are really important, and they will feature in future work of the Commission. So it may well be that we can come back to that in the future.
Okay, that would be really helpful if the Commission was able to look to see what if any work had been done to assess adequacy of that, then that would be helpful. Thank you. I have no other questions in this area. Thanks.
Thanks, Pam. Do you want to lead us into our next theme? I've got you down. Next.
Thank you. And we've kind of touched on it, actually, but have the Commission considered any ways in which we may, in Scotland, maintain the value of benefits without changing from the CPI? Because I note from your papers that you say considering keeping that link is appropriate for now, but may need to be looked at differently in the future. What kind of mechanisms are open to the government to do that?
I think currently, as we mentioned in the report, the September CPI is probably the most sensible mechanism in the short term. But in the longer term, particularly when agency agreements with the Department for Work and Pensions have come to an end, there may be scope to take a different approach to how inflation is measured in relation to Social Security uprating. So we did identify some issues in our 2019 uprating strategy report. So I think we would certainly want to be involved in any sort of future discussion about what the policy on uprating could be going forward.
Did you mention a timescale for that kind of discussion, or that you would expect that discussion to start in?
I'm not aware of a particular timescale. Okay. I think it would depend on what was sensible in relation to the agency agreements and other factors around Social Security.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Pam. I'll move to questions from James Dornan, who's joining us online.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. Can I ask you, obviously inflation is very high just now, and it is expected to fall rapidly. Inflation is still likely to be greater in the UK than the rest of Europe. Did you have, what do you think are the implications of this for the benefit and operating policy, and also how it's going to affect the people who need the support that we're giving them?
Yes. I mean, obviously, inflation is difficult to predict, but certainly some of the forecasts at the moment are looking at potentially 4 to 5% this coming year. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the cost of living is going to go down. It probably means that the cost of living is perhaps not going to rise as fast as it has been doing in the recent past. And as you say, the particular elements that low-income households are likely to use and spend their money on disproportionately compared to higher income groups are items like food and fuel, and they are the items which have been increasing within the overall CPI average rate. So the implications are that obviously if the uprating is that if inflation goes down, then benefits are uprated at a higher amount. So going forward, those uprated benefits could make a greater contribution to some of the principles. So, for example, reducing poverty. But the obviously the way that the inflation measure works and uprating works is that it copes with peaks and troughs, and it's in theory evens itself out. But obviously at a time when there is very high inflation, then, as we mentioned a bit earlier on, there's a case perhaps to look at if there are particular mechanisms outside of uprating which need to be brought to bear more quickly than an uprating would be in order to tackle issues around the cost of living.
Yeah, it's kind of a lucky dip, isn't it? I mean, about when the uprating is made, the reference month, and how that's going to affect your payments over the coming period. But the example you've stated there, that's a kind of positive advantage for the people who are receiving it. But what sort of disadvantages do you see in the single reference months? And is there any way that you as an organisation have been able to feed into the system being used?
Well, the Commission obviously looks at the regulations that the government refers to it regarding uprating every year. And as I mentioned earlier on, there was a policy report produced in 2019 concerning the broad approach to uprating. Uprating is obviously a kind of system whereby if the reference period is in September, then in times of fairly stable or low inflation, then things may tend to even out over time. I think obviously the issues at the moment are sort of higher and more volatile inflation. But that's perhaps where some of the additional measures around cost of living and having various uplifts to or increases during a year rather than waiting for a particular uprating point. I think obviously the time lag between the September reference period and when people receive their increased benefit in April means that it is slow to respond. But then again, it's sometimes difficult to think about what an alternative might be. Ideally, it might be something closer to when people receive their payment, but setting it in September does allow for seasonal variations to be dealt with. And it also enables, it also links into the time frame for budgeting process. So it's one of the issues that could probably be looked at in longer term, but in the short term, the September figure is...
I appreciate it's difficult, but I mean, what you seem to be saying there is that the way it's being done is for the benefit of the system, as opposed to the benefit of the individual. And I'm not criticising at all here. I understand how difficult that is. But do you, is there a way, and you touched on it earlier on, about trying to get some mechanism outside of the particular month, but is there a way, for example, just now we seem to be particularly badly hit, and I mean the UK here, with inflation generally accepted down to Brexit, but is there a way that circumstances such as that could be taken into account, or there could be some flexibility where, you know, an increase in support over a period of time, even if the inflation starts to fall, could be put into the system?
Well, I think probably that flexibility is there, and the cost of living payments and energy support and cottage child payment support has been introduced to, as part of that in-year flexibility. I think it is important that that any system can be administered so that people do receive the payments as soon as they can. But certainly at the moment, because of the timescale that it takes to make those decisions and implement, then September is the seems to be the most practicable option at the moment. But as we were saying earlier on, there's scope to maybe look at potential alternatives in the longer term.
Can I just ask one final question, convener? And thank you for your patience, Ms. Howard. Do you have any input into how these decisions will be made as an organisation today, as a commission? Do you have any input into what you think might be a sensible suggestion and way going forward?
Well, the commission offers detailed advice on regulations which are referred to it by ministers. So if there were to be a review, then I would hope and expect that the commission would be involved in some way.
That's good. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you, James. We'll now move to our next theme for questions on the Scottish Child Payment, and I'll move first to Deputy Convener Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Marilyn. I note the recommendation around making clear whether an increase to the Scottish Child Payment is uprating or a different sort of increase. And I do doubt that, you know, folk who get more money than they expected will mind or maybe even know the difference between an increase and an uprating. So could you explain why you think it's important for the government to make that distinction?
Yes. I think it also relates to what we were talking about a bit earlier on. Our report refers to in-year increases. And obviously they're important, particularly if uprating is only an annual process. But actually being clear about what those increases are for can actually help people understand when their benefit will increase and by what amount and on what basis. And it will also help people who advise claimants to do that. So the response to our recommendations from ministers was that officials were going to consider whether those in-year increases can be communicated a bit more clearly and earlier at the time.
Okay, thank you. The Scottish Child Payment has, of course, had a 150% increase in the last 8 months and is now five times more than what campaigners originally called for in the Give Me Five campaign. So on the increase of £25, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation did say the full rollout of the Scottish Child Payment is a watershed moment for tackling poverty in Scotland and the rest of the UK should take notice. Would you agree with that?
Certainly the increase in Scottish Child Payment clearly makes a significant contribution to reducing poverty. So that would certainly be welcome.
And the payment, of course, doesn't exist elsewhere in the UK. So I'd like to just finally ask you the same question that Child Poverty Action Group has posed, which is it not the case that if the Scottish Government can make this kind of serious investment in protecting children from poverty, that so too can the UK Government?
Well, I'm afraid what the UK Government does is sort of beyond the Commission's remit.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Emma. I'll now move to questions from Faisal Chowdhury, who is joining us online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I just have a small question. What data and evidences were collected prior to the decision to increase the Scottish Child Payment?
In terms of the uprating report which we've just produced, because the timescales were quite short, the Commission itself didn't have the chance to engage external stakeholders in discussions, although we have done some desk-based research and some of the publications from various organisations were considered, and they are referenced in the report as well.
Thank you, Convener. I don't have any other question on this theme.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to our next theme, and I have a question myself. So, those who find themselves just above the qualifying criteria for benefits are in an extremely vulnerable position just now. I know SCOS suggested that the Scottish Government might want to re-examine earnings thresholds. Do you have any opinion on how this could be calculated? So, for example, should increases reflect wage inflation or price inflation or another method?
Well, that's certainly a very good question, and certainly at the moment the uprating for the earnings thresholds in carers allowance was undertaken by 5.5%, which is the average wages figure, and obviously at the same time CPI was higher at 10.1%. I mean, certainly at the moment where there's an agency agreement with the Department for Work and Pensions, then how those thresholds are uprated for relevant benefits needs to align with that. But certainly we at the Commission believe that there may be a case to re-examine how earnings thresholds are uprated in the longer term. And we would hope to consider the earnings rules for Scottish carers assistance in more detail during our consideration of draft regulations, which we anticipate we will have sight of later in the year.
Absolutely, thank you. Just kind of leading on from that, in terms of that uprating, so many Social Security Scotland benefits are obviously passported from DWP low-income benefits, so eligibility is essentially out with Scotland's control. Does SCOS think that a more effective way of tackling the cost of living would be to have all Social Security powers devolved so that we didn't have to rely on passporting them from UK government benefits?
That wasn't something that we considered in relation to this particular uprating report, I'm afraid.
Yeah, no, just I'm in a kind of more general sense, do you think that would make that easier in terms of dealing with Scotland's social security system?
Well, I'm a new member of the Commission, so I don't know if there's been previous work on this, but I certainly wouldn't be able to respond to you today, I'm afraid.
That's fine, Madeline. I don't want to put you on the spot. I'll move on to questions from Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, and good morning, and welcome. I hope you're settling in and enjoying your new role, and I'm coming to look forward to working with you. I just wondered, have you previously or recently, just following on a question from the convener, looked at passporting benefits and how they interrelate between the DWP and the new Social Security Scotland? And if not, is that something that you might want to look at in the future when you have time?
In terms of the uprating report, we simply considered whether there was an agency agreement in place which would affect the uprating policy. Clearly, the interaction between reserved and devolved benefits is a matter which is likely to come up with regards to a range of regulations, but there was nothing specific in relation to uprating.
OK, thank you. That's all I've got, Camino.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. I'm just now moving back to Faisal Chowdhury online for a question.
Thank you, convener. Just want to add what the question you've asked, that is the increase is going to reflect on household bills as well, because quite a lot of people are, families are getting hit by gas and electricity bills as well. So I just don't want to add what you've asked, just wanted to add this as well. For the question.
Yes, I mean, obviously, household bills are still very high, relatively speaking. And as I think we were talking about a little bit earlier on, food and fuel in particular is increasing at a rate which is faster than the CPI average. Although inflation may be due to reduce overall in the coming year, some of those aspects which increase household bills may still be rising, but not quite as fast as they were rising a few months ago.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Faisal. And our final line of questioning, I'll move back to Jeremy.
Thank you. I'm just wondering, in regard to the information that you got from Scottish Government, in regard to the transparency, the quality of the information, the timeliness of the information. I know in previous reports, there's been an issue around getting all that information at the right time and in the right format. Was that an issue here, or were you happy with how it was provided to you?
Well, obviously, the uprating process is a very compressed timescale, so that does limit the kind of additional work that the Commission could do. So, for example, we didn't have the time to go out to external stakeholders in this instance, but we did receive timely and helpful responses from the government in relation to our role.
Thank you. And then my final question is just around, again, a bit of about the process. As a committee, we're very keen to look at a human rights approach to decision making and how that works. Again, is that something you as a commission are taking and looking at in regard to one of the principles you're judging these by? Of a human rights approach, and you see that also within the decision making of Scottish Government?
Obviously, the scrutiny that the Commission undertakes takes into account the Social Security principles and various human rights provisions. So, we obviously want to be looking at the regulations that are referred to us through that particular lens, and it's something that we may wish to consider further in the future.
I'm grateful. Thank you, and thank you, Gavino.
Thanks, Jeremy. That brings us to the end of our evidence session, so I just want to say thank you very much to Marilyn for joining us this morning and providing evidence, especially considering you have only very recently been appointed to the Commission. So really looking forward to working with you going forward, and thanks again. We will now move into... Thanks. We will now move into private session. Can members who are joining us remotely please use the Teams link to join the meeting? Thank you.